This is what powered humanity for decades. But it's on its way out, unless the oil and car industries have something up their sleeve.
E-fuels.
E-fuels.
Synthetic fuels.
Synthetic fuels.
Climate neutral fuel, that would be huge. There are more than a billion cars in the world, the majority still running on internal combustion engines, not to mention all the trucks, ships and planes. So what's the magic fuel that they are talking about, and can it really help to clean up the transport sector? The idea behind e-fuels or synthetic fuels, as they are sometimes called, is not actually that new. This guy, Friedrich Bergui, came up with the basic principle in 1913. During World War II, more research went into it, and the basic principle hasn't really changed since then. You need two main ingredients to make synthetic fuels, water and carbon. The water is split into hydrogen and oxygen. This can be done in a process called electrolysis that, if you power it with renewable sources, causes no CO2 emissions. For the carbon, we can suck CO2 that already has been released out of the air or collect it from biomass and split off one oxygen atom to get carbon monoxide. Then we put this along with a hydrogen in a so-called Fischer-Tropsch reactor. In there, the two gases form long-chained carbohydrates. These are the same chemical structures you find in fossil fuels like crude oil. E-fuels just smell a little different.
Aber es ist deutlich
weniger. Aber nicht so.
Nee, nee, es ist deutlich weniger.
Überhaupt nicht wie so Tankstelle jetzt oder so normalerweise.
It doesn't smell as aggressive as regular gasoline. But before these building blocks can be used in engines though, they still need to be refined. Looking at this, you might think these are quite a lot of production steps, and you're right. In fact, the process is so laborious that e-fuels are still super expensive. According to Porsche, you're looking at $10 per liter for synthetic gasoline. That's 10 times more than what you'd pay for regular gasoline, at least before Russia's war on Ukraine. And it's not really clear how much cheaper e-fuels could possibly get. Figures range between $1 and $5 per liter.
Let's keep in mind that some of those future cost estimates are for 2050 rather than the near term.
This is Nikita Pavlenko. He analyzes the economics of synthetic fuels in every detail imaginable.
So we need to make policy and plan ahead for decarbonization with those upfront high costs over the next decade, rather than looking ahead to the 2050 costs.
And the price is not the only problem with e-fuels. In order for them to be green, they need to be made with renewable energy. And the little renewable energy we currently have is actually needed for something else.
We still need to decarbonize the grid, so there's still a lot of coal and gas on the grid.
This is Gerrit de Kock. He focuses on the huge electricity consumption of synthetic fuels.
We need to rapidly accelerate that decarbonization to make sure that the electricity we use in our electric vehicles, in our homes, in our heat pumps, that is zero carbon as soon as possible.
As only 29% of all electricity we are producing comes from renewable sources, using mainly dirty power to create supposedly clean fuels totally defeats the purpose. So before we can make clean e-fuels, our electricity supplies need to be clean. One idea from the e-fuel industry is to concentrate power production where lots and lots of renewable energy is available. The Sun Belt, for example. As the name suggests, these are the places on Earth that get the most sunshine. Or take southern Chile with its very strong winds. German companies Siemens and Porsche are looking to use them to produce e-fuels. They have even produced a virtual reality tour to promote the idea. The problem is that these countries need to decarbonize their energy production as well.
That is one big factor. The other one is, I would say that there is none of the infrastructure available to do this. I mean, I'm talking not just the physical pipelines, but also the regulatory infrastructure. So there is no rules in place. There's no certification. There's no bilateral agreements. That's not a detail that is quite important.
Renewable energy is still scarce, and even as it becomes more and more available, we should still think about the most efficient way to use it. When you power a car with synthetic fuels, a lot of the energy you put in initially gets lost along the way. There's a study that looked a bit closer at this. In the electrolysis process, you lose about 36% of energy. Capturing CO2 takes you down another 7%. The whole synthesis and refining process takes up about 21% of the initial energy, and another 28% gets lost in the internal combustion engine. So in this study, only about 8% of the energy you put in actually makes it to the wheel. Depending on the process and the equipment used, it might be a little more. But generally speaking, efficiency ranges between 8 and 18%. So that would be more than 80% of valuable renewable energy just wasted. If you use the same energy to charge a battery and power an electric vehicle, around 70% of the initial energy makes it to the wheel. But of course, there is one big problem with electric vehicles, which is not that many people drive them yet. Most still drive cars with combustion engines and can't afford to switch to an electric vehicle. And that's why the industry often markets e-fuels as a bridge technology, meaning it's a stepping stone to reach 100% electric vehicles.
Usually a bridge helps us to get somewhere. You go over the bridge to go somewhere, so it's preparing a more sustainable option.
This is Falco Ueckert. He analyzes the potential integration of e-fuels into Germany at the Potsdam Climate Institute.
E-fuel production is in its infancies, and at the same time, the battery electric car is already diffusing into the market at market shares of 30%.
The problem with the bridge technology argument is that the e-fuel bridge is still under construction. Let's take the Siemens factory in Chile, for example, that we talked about earlier. In 2026, it is forecast to produce 500 million liters of e-fuel. That might sound like a lot, but the USA alone consumed 467 billion liters of gasoline in 2020. 500 million is barely 0.1% of that. But e-fuels are not completely useless. Projects like this can help us use renewable energy that we otherwise couldn't tap into.
The huge offer of wind energy there is completely unused.
This is Markus Speit. He's the lead developer of the e-fuel project in Chile.
And it would remain unused if we wouldn't convert it into molecules which are transportable. There is no grid connection in this remote part, and there's also no grid connection possible. So the only way to access this huge offering of cheap renewable energy is converting it to hydrogen and then into the derivatives.
Meaning e-fuels can give us access to renewable energy we could not otherwise use. And then there is another big advantage that e-fuels have.
Energy density.
Batteries might work for cars, but when you need a lot of energy in a small space, e-fuels might be the better option. In that regard, they are pretty similar to diesel or kerosene, which might make them a good carbon-neutral fuel for ships or for planes. Batteries that would generate enough power would be so heavy the plane couldn't take off. But just to replace 2% of all kerosene in the EU with a synthetic alternative by 2030, we would need to build around 5,000 additional offshore wind turbines. 5,000, that's a lot. E-fuels might come too late to be a real bridge technology. It's unclear how quickly the cost will come down and how much will be available. So while e-fuels might have their use cases, they are extremely unlikely to save the internal combustion engine. Sorry. So what do you think about e-fuels? Yay or nay? Please let me know in the comments. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel. We post new videos on the environment every Friday.